here, ready, open, and as fabulous as possible. These are your sweets, Makeda
and Melanie,
and you're now listening to Gurl.
Gurl, what?
So, you know, like we start every episode, Melanie, please talk about the drink for the day.
All right, so drink aligns to our guests, and we are having some hood lemonade, and I'm going to let our guests tell us what's in the drink.
Absolutely. We are having hood lemonade, which is Moscato champagne mixed with pink lemonade, and then you're going to want to garnish your glass with some lemons and also some strawberries.
Kita,
that does sound delicious.
Did you hear the garnish? Did you hear that part?
Yeah. No. Say that part again.
Garnish the glass.
Oh, that sounds delicious. That sounds delicious. Now, for the audience, you know, for our listeners, you know, we do this segment every episode, and you know, we want to lighten the mood. I mean, we're attempting to create a show that's both educational and entertainment. So for those of you that don't drink, don't worry. We're not here encouraging any of those behaviors. We just want our little podcast to lighten up the mood as much as possible, even though we talk about quite a few different things.
Okay, so audience, you know, really y'all
quick,
know.
Can we just get a quick introduction for our guests?
Okay, wait, but before you say that, I just want the audience to know. Y'all know Makeda is the politically correct one. Thank you, Makeda, for the disclaimer, but you know I don't care, right?
I know, but we have to care.
I know.
Because, you know, I want to be fair. I want to balance out. When I hear enough people say, like, you know, I just want to acknowledge we're not forcing anyone to drink. And for the most part, we're not really drinking these, you know, substances ourselves. But if you are interested, these are some very tasty treats.
Okay, but we grown. I hear you. You're right. You're correct. We're grown, and this is girl time, and we don't do this often. So anyway, on that note, I am going to let our guest, TJ, introduce herself. I'm just going to give a little brief brief intro before she starts. So I met TJ through our favorite butterfly.
I love butterfly.
We love butterfly. I hope butterfly is listening. So I met TJ through butterfly. And I have I've set my shop up at her events, and I'm a poetry fanatic. As a matter of fact, the night I met my husband, it was because I was going to a poetry spot first, and I ended up where he was. So poetry is something that even when I was younger, I had a journal and I would write and stuff. Did I ever say it in front of anybody? No, but I've always had a love for words and a vibe, and Love Jones is like my favorite movie of all time. Yes. Anybody that knows me knows. I even had a poem from Love Jones in my wedding. Wow. So anyway, enough of that. And so I'm all about vibe. I'm all about good heart. And the vibe I got from TJ is that she need to come on to the Gurl Cave. So that's why she's here. And I'm going to let her introduce herself.
Well, thank you for inviting me, first off, and you have those excellent vibes also. So I'm a poet, as you were saying, and spoken word artist, and then I'm also an author. My series is called Hood Lemonade, and I'm real proud of it, my first series, and right now it's showing 5-star marks, you know, across the board. I'm also known as a positive energy and love enthusiast. People that follow me know that I'm the half full type person. You know what I mean? Regardless of what's going on, if you tell me a problem, I'm going to be try to say something positive to help us to pull it in a positive direction, you know? So that is also part of what I'm known of. And then also just providing the creative space for artists through the events that I do. For all those, right. That would be a description of TJ, pretty much.
Alrighty. So, what we normally do, this is our order. They've been asking me, Keita, trying to see what we're going to talk about. You know, how they always do when they come on here. And I'm like, I don't tell. We just vibe. So, but we do have an order, though. The first thing we do is our M&M moment. And then we're going to go into our Hot Topics, which we're going to bring you into our Hot Topics. And hopefully we can get your mama to talk since she's in the building. So we are now going to go into our M&M moment.
M&M moment. M&M moment. M&M moment.
And Keita, you're going to go first today because I went first the last time.
Nothing has changed. I'm on the road. I'm in Central Florida, working with candidates and basically some great opportunities are starting to align itself. I've kind of connected with some other individuals that, hopefully in the next few, weeks, I will announce those developments. But, like I said, the McClune Group is still out here consulting candidates. I recently am exploring some PR services for a couple of entertainers, and things are starting to kind of move in a different, move in a forward direction, and I'm also getting involved in a couple of other business ventures. So it's been very busy the last few weeks, and the McClune Group has been in operations for a couple of years, but I think it hasn't been until 2018 that things are starting to be realized, partnerships are starting to develop, and I'm really excited about where things are going. So, I'm spending a lot of my time away, but I'm still, in the Gurl Cave in spirit. So, Melanie, what do you have to share?
So, those of you that maybe this is your first time tuning in, so you really don't know Makeda and I, but we both are entrepreneurs. And so, M&M Moment is a chance for us to highlight our little things that we have going on. But we created and designed this platform not just to empower ourselves, but also to empower other women. Mm-hmm. And not that we discriminate. We've had all kind of nationalities and cultures on the show. Mm-hmm. But we are trying to focus in on a community that's in need right now, and that's our community. That's right. The Black community. Mm-hmm. So we are using this platform to empower other Black women and also give them an opportunity to for us to love up on them and showcase what they are here and what their purpose is for in life. Mm-hmm. So my moment, I had a lot going on within these last 2 weeks. Yesterday I had the pleasure of hanging out with some beautiful boss chicks in South Florida. I attended the second annual Boss Talk Expo. And I met a lot of beautiful people who are just doing their thing. And it was an expo focused on teaching entrepreneurs how to brand. Mm. And so I met some really cool people that are going to be featured on our show. So it was a great movement. Also, we have we launched our Girl What edition of the Wakanda mugs. And they are pink and green, but we have other colors. So that went on our Shinshi Decor website, and it's focused on our Girl What movement. And then I wanted to make sure that I start including a little bit about decorating, since that's my passion. Aside from teaching, which I did that all for the last 2 weeks, we're getting ready for testing. I wanted to talk about some trends in decorating really quickly. So right now, what's hot now is rich and bolder pigment shades. So if you're into decorating now, you might want to. I know I change up all the time. You could change up to navy blues and deep violets and that could be for wall decor or furniture, and pull in some velvet furniture also. So that's what's in. And emerald green, which is my birth month color. So that I wanted to throw that in there. But other than that, that's it for the M&M moment. We got a lot going on.
Yeah, we certainly have a lot of things to cover, especially including our guests, to make sure that we cover all the discussion on Love Jones and hood poetry and all of those things. But let's get into a couple of little highlights of stories. But, you know, before I get into that, I want to say that I realized that a lot of, you know, that in the past, these, you know, what is reported can be, you know, on for my end, very political. It is because I am very involved in paying attention to what's happening in the universe as far as politics. I will just say this, that, you know, no matter what is going on in the world, you know, all politics is local. So I'm encouraging some of our listeners to, if you're an educator, you know, visit your local school board meetings. You know, if you're just a citizen that's just interested in knowing what's happening in your community, take a minute to, like, put it on your schedule and visit your county and city commission meetings and city council meetings. It's really important because I really want people to understand that what's happening in the White House and what's happening nationally, yes, that's affecting us, but what's happening in our backyard is what's going to affect us immediately. So I just wanted to kind of say that really quick. And as many of you know, that there is still the ongoing Mueller investigation, and recently I thought it was pretty interesting that Maxine Waters, I believe she was on Joy AM, that kind of said something about Robert Mueller is, you know, doing his investigation, but she believes that if he doesn't you know, get Donald Trump 45 impeached, that Stormy Daniels will. And for those that are not paying attention, Stormy Daniels is the porn star, was engaged in some form of a relationship with our current person in the White House, and, you know,
number 45. That's what we never refer to him. Yeah.
To that. Whenever you get a chance, please feel free to Google and look it up yourself. I don't want to get into the meat and the potatoes of it, and I don't want our segments to be fully on, you know, what's happening there, because what's happening there, it may end up being a long process, and I'm
so tired.
I'm going to choose not to continue to cover.
You know what? It's funny that you said that.
Recently,
she can't hear me.
Rick Scott
has, Makeda, can you hear me?
Signed a bill. I guess, and it's an abbreviated version of some gun legislation, which they are trying to add bump stops and other things to the law, you know, because last month there was a school massacre in Broward County that is now has gained, you know, national attention. And again, that's just a little abbreviated version of what's happening there. Melanie, I don't know if you want to.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's interesting that you said what you just said, because when I was prepping, I'm like, dog, I really don't want to talk about this man, but there's so much going on with this fool. Like, I found an interesting story that CNN published, and the headline was, or the title of the article was, 5 days, 15 big stories, one Trump White House. Mm-hmm. So, like, in five, it's almost like a soap opera. It's like, in 5 days, this man has so much going on. It's like unheard of. He is like, I don't even have the words to describe the foolishness. And then I'm looking, he wants the death penalty for drug dealers. I'm like, does he just jot down everything that comes in his head?
I think so.
And then
yeah,
he just wakes up and, yeah, okay, what do I have to, he just goes to his people. What do I have to do to make this happen?
Right.
It's unreal. And all I could do is just tell everybody, yes, I agree with Makeda. We need to get involved locally. We need to get involved as much as we can. But at the same time, y'all, we got to pray.
Yes.
Because it's some serious times right now.
Right.
And this is all the more reason why I feel like our platform is so important.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was talking to a lot of the young ladies at the expo over the weekend, they agree. Like, Black women, we are like we are the cornerstones of our community.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so important right now that we pull together. And I don't know, this man is on a mission.
Yeah, but if we even look at that, know, like I said, I want to reiterate, you know, what has been happening in Virginia, especially of what happened in Alabama, where immediately after the Alabama election, black women were acknowledged as the ones
who
turned, you know, to right a wrong or right.
Yeah.
And we were the ones that actually are leading. Well, I wouldn't say so much that we're leading the, you know, the black or minority communities. I think black women are the ones that are taking the helm to help turn right, you know, turn wrong
into right. Yeah,
we've become more of the moral compass. You know, we're far more educated than before. Mm-hmm. You know, we're more heads of households than before. And I think that we are just one of those platforms that should just, you know, kind of continue to set those trends and put out those reminders. Another thing I was listening to, I believe it's called Urban View. It's on XM Radio. And it's kind of like it's a political channel, but it is most of the hosts of those shows are African American. There is Karen Hunter, there is Al Sharpton, there's quite a few other shows that are on that show. If you guys are on XM Radio, I tell you, go ahead and listen. But there was this show that I know that it was I believe it was a black Republican. And it was so interesting that he said in this show that if we pay attention to what's happening in the news, it's all doom and gloom. So, when he said that, he made a point. He read a bunch of headlines. I think there was an incident with Ben Carson and spending $30,000 on silverware for HUD, and, you know, a whole bunch of things that are happening in the White House. What I want, you know, I think I want to not only harp on what's happening and what we need to be mindful of and pay attention to, but let's also talk about... Let's also highlight and talk about some good things.
Yeah.
I say that to say, I think that is one of the consistencies that I think we are also working on plugging.
Right.
And I can't think of one of my social media friends on Facebook, but he is the hungry man.
The hungry black man.
The hungry black man. He's out of South Florida. He's a Sigma. I found that out recently. Shout out to Black Organization. And he did something that I just wanted to say it was quite amazing. He, you know, the Drake show, the Drake music video where he went around communities in Miami and was like handing out money and doing different things like single mothers and all this stuff. Well, Hungry Black Man has been very, also one of those strong voices about supporting black businesses and the community. And he actually, I think, put a few dollars together, bought some groceries, and went to a neighborhood, I want to say in Liberty City, off of 62nd and I think 17th or 10th, and knocked on, you know, I guess must have spoken to a few people, and went to someone's door randomly and knocked on the door and talked to this family and offered them groceries, also talked, you know, asked them questions about things that they need, things that the kids in that house need. But I'm acknowledging that because what was really what stood out was he said he didn't just want to, you know, keep making plans and talking about and about how we can help the communities, but he said, you know, just get up and do something. And so I just wanted to take that moment to acknowledge. I saw that the other day, and I was immediately thinking, like, what can we do? I know that we can do a lot, but he, you know, that's an example of someone, you know, here in South Florida that just said, I'm just going to do something, and I'm going to continue to do something. He also rented out the theater in Aventura for Wrinkle in Time. The response wasn't as the Black Panther response was, but he is actively doing things to support entertainment, to support our community.
Yeah, no, it's true. I mean, that's something that we definitely, as since we have our platform, we probably can, we're at that point now where we need to start thinking about doing initiatives like that. But I do, I kind of want to hear from TJ about, you know, and she has her mama here, and I keep trying to egg her on to talk, but I don't know if she's going to talk. But, like, what do you think are some things that we could probably do in our local community to help out, to deviate from the doom and gloom, like Makeda mentioned?
Well, I think the events and things like that are kind of what that is as well. Mm-hmm. Because at those type of events, you do have a feeling of camaraderie, mm-hmm. you know what I mean, togetherness, and you also don't feel judged. Right. You know what I mean? And it's a feeling of love there. And I think that that's important in our community. You know what I mean? Because okay. we don't have a lot of things like that. So when you can have something that brings you to a more artistic environment,
that's true.
You know what I mean? It grows us all. You yeah. know what I mean? So I think that's something that we can do. And I also think that women empowerment is yeah. like the most important. Just being a part of the Black community, you know, we all know that we wish we all got along a little better.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? They talk about the proverbial crabs in the bucket and this and that. I just hope we can get to a place where we all can be positive for each other. You know what I mean?
Right.
You see another sister or brother doing something, and some of us are like that.
Yeah.
But it's just not on as big of a scale as it could be. Right. We're genuinely happy for each other. We're supporting each other. We all making our community strong.
Exactly.
So I think that's important, you know?
I agree. I mean, I'm all about positivity. Like, even on the event I went to the other day, I didn't have business cards for Girl What. But when I thought about it, I was like, you know what? I'm kind of glad I didn't, because it forced me to really connect.
Yes.
And not just give a card. Like, yes. I really had to talk. I really had to feel. I really had to. And then it was more like, you know what? I don't want to give you a card. I want you to go on my page, right. and I want you to follow me so we can connect right now. Right. Like, I don't want you to take this card and walk away and then I never hear from you again.
Yeah.
So I just think right now, the times that we're in, we need to talk. We need to be more conscious about not just saying, how you doing? And you're not really paying attention to you. We should be saying, no, how are you really doing?
Right.
You know, like
yes.
those things. We need to change the culture of our community. Mm-hmm. At the same time, I agree with Makeda. We do need to become more active and more aware right. of what's going on in the community. Because legally, you know what I mean? Like, we are kind of, you know, we'll say, like, even after the shooting at Stoneman Douglas, it's true. I see people say, you know, things happen. We get all riled up and then it dies off and then we never do anything.
That's what happens.
And I think a part of why we don't do anything is because we really don't know what to do.
Yes.
So I think maybe
that's the
question.
I think part of it is that there's so much that goes on with what we should do. And then it's like you said, you don't avalanched with, okay, this is like we went into the discussion on, you know, at the end of the day, a lot of these social issues, we start to talk about race and how it affects one community more than another. Why is it? I know last episode we talked about why is it such an outrage and now we should be doing this and now let's push all of these guns and laws and bills because it has affected a community of wealth, a community that probably that never really had encountered these type of issues that you know, goes on, I won't say regularly, but it happens more so in the inner cities than, you know, in some other communities. There's so much that's going out, and since we have access to so much information at one time, we don't know what to pay attention to more than the other. And mm-hmm. I think that is a part of the problem.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I am really grateful that we have built this little opportunity opportunity to talk about it, because I don't think that there is enough people that are at least on the fence one way or another, that's at least, you know, let's talking about it. You know, again, Melanie and I strike that balance where I am a little bit more mindful of, like, some of the things that may be happening politically, and you know, at the and sometimes, you know, we kind of go off the cuff. But you know, we're trying to strike a balance where we are starting to turn our attention on to topics and things that are important, and also, you know, figuring out what is the next step,
right?
The action.
And I actually, I actually just jotted down like that. I think that's a show we need to have, like, because I would love to know, like, how do these laws get passed so fast? Like how does that process happen? But I don't want to take away from TJ's time, but I just jotted it down. Like, I think that's a part of the problem, is that we as Black people don't know what can we do to get that thing to stop. Like, how did it pass so fast that educators can now carry guns? Like, how did that happen so fast? And I don't think we really understand what we can do to stop stuff like that from happening. So I think that is a show that we definitely need to have. And Makeda, you probably would have to take the lead on that, because you're a little bit more, you know, you're in the political arena. And maybe we need to also reach out to other people in politics in South Florida that can, you know, enlighten our community as to what is it that we actually can do. If we need to bring someone from on the show from NAACP, or maybe we need to, we don't know. I know for me, I could call and I don't have a problem calling and emailing whoever I need to call and email, but is that enough?
Right.
And am I calling the right people? Like, those kind of questions, I think we need to have a show about. You're absolutely right, because it's like, things are happening right over our nose, and we don't know how it's happening. It's just happening, and we can't stop it. And every time we wake up in the morning, something else has happened. Something else has been passed. Something, like, and I don't understand, how does that happen?
Right.
So
I will say this. You know, follow the money. You know, what they have been saying in the media over and over and over again is how strong the NRA is. And it's not just strong because it's just strong. It's strong because they're organized. It's strong because they're financially, you know, strong. You know, they can mobilize their, you know, they're a one-issue organization. Second Amendment, right to bear arms, every and any type of arsenal you can think of, they want. They do not want any means for you to stop that.
Right.
And so you, when it's just like, you know, I've had this conversation with a few people, and I don't want to interrupt the, you know.
Yeah, because I want to get into the fun stuff, because this is heavy. Right now, this is heavy.
Second. We get into the fun stuff, I know. Second, but, you know, when it's just like when you talk politics.
Right.
You know, we're basically a two-party system. You have the Republicans that, on many accounts, you can kind of say they are for money and big business and self-interest. Self-interest being the politicians wanting to remain in their seat for forever and a day. That needs to change. On the Democratic side, you have the same issue with politicians that are career politicians that's been in office for forever and a day.
Yeah.
They run one office, they run to the next, and it goes on and on and on, and they've been They've been in the public for like 20, 30, 40, 50 years, and that. But what I think some of the challenges are with Democrats is that we don't have a one-issue, we're not a issue organization. We're like 40. So with that being said, you know, there are a lot of challenges. When I go to I am a registered Democrat. I do political consulting mainly for Democrats, and I have Republican friends, but I have not necessarily done business with them. Not that I don't want to. We're a state where it's Republican driven. Anyway, I'll say all of this to say, you know, our issues as far as what's happening affecting us in our communities, as far as the two-tier system, there's not a good representation. organizing and showing up at these meetings. So we end up not being the focus on what should happen, you know, and so there lies the problem.
It's kind of like if you're not in the room, it's kind of like if you're not in the room of the meeting and there's something you're passionate about and you're not in the room, then nobody else is passionate about that but you. So, yeah. I understand what you're saying.
Imagine a room where it is, you know, 150 individuals that are Democrats that are representing this party, and only three to ten people out of 150 are minorities.
Yeah.
Hence lies how the meeting is going to run.
Right.
Hence
I got you.
Hence lies how the leadership within that party is going to look. And I'm saying this to say, it is important for folks to get a big picture as to why things are happening to us versus for us. And so anyway.
All right. I've jotted that down. We are definitely going to have a show about that. And not just to talk about it. We're going to come up with some solutions.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
To see, you know, what can this little platform... I'm saying little, but you know what? I'm going to stop saying little. I'm going to stop saying little because this platform is going to grow. It's growing already. And God is blessing this platform. And I'm just going to put that out there. So I'm going to stop saying little. I'm going to stop minimizing it because I'm seeing God's work in this podcast ministry is what I'm going to call it. And so I marked that on my things to do. We're going to have a show about that. And we just got to do whatever we can to promote it, to get people to listen. Mm-hmm. And it might be a part one, a part two, it might be something that we need to add as a series of, you know, every night. This is part one, and then maybe another time we're going to have part two of solutions of how to have our voice at the table. So, without further ado, I'm going to get into our featured guest. And so, our episode 33 is about when we fell in love with words. It's a love story about words, and words are, the love for words, I think, is absent in music, in our world today, in the community, and I really feel like some of that is why love is gone. I don't know. TJ?
I agree with that, because if you take it to the music, you know, just think about 90s music, R&B, everybody sung about love, and it wasn't embarrassing to be in love with somebody. We are in the age of, I'm savage, you and your feelings. So what, I'm in my feelings? I got feelings. I'm human.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? So I think that does have a lot to do with it, that we're not hearing lyrics about loving each other. You know, now, you know, I can't love you. I'm savage. I'm going to the next one now.
Mm-hmm,
you know,
sure.
So I think that has a lot to do with what's going on now. You know what I mean?
Okay. I totally agree. Okay, mm-hmm. So TJ, when did you fall in love with words? That's my first question for you.
I fell in love with words really early. I think I wrote my first story fifth grade, so I had to be about 10. Hmm. And I used to pass my stories around to my little friends, and they'll read the stories and, what's next? And I think that's when I realized I had something. Like, they're reading my little stories and want to know what's next in my little stories. So that was the beginning of, you know,
that's awesome.
My love with words. And back then, I used to also be into singing, rapping. So, you know, all that is lyrical.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You writing songs and you rapping and stuff like that. So, yeah.
It's funny because as a teacher... and we have somebody else in the room that's going to be anonymous, but she's a teacher too. But it's hard now to get kids to want to read, to want to write. And I remember growing up, even now, I got a little better. For a long time, I had a very hard time communicating verbally.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to writing it down, I can write down exactly what I want to say. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to, if I could just read you, can I just... Even to my little, you know, my little boyfriend, even with my husband, sometimes I express myself better if I could just read. Can I just write it first and then can I read it to you? Because when you're in front of the person, sometimes it's hard to express yourself.
Right.
So,
I think I can also, not to interrupt, but I can also agree with you too. I've been in plenty of situations where if it is a deep, you know, discussion, a hard subject to tackle, you know, even with, you know, in relationships, trying to get to know someone and it's going on to a heavier topic, I would much rather talk about it via text. Well, not necessarily via text, but on written form. Let me just get out my feelings because I don't know what I might say in person. And I think that's a lot for most of us, where some of our thoughts are not coming out as clearly as we would like, especially when it comes to, you know, discussions and our emotions. It's very hard to kind of separate the two. Let me ask. I know that we asked when did you start? What made you decide that you wanted to get it to be a poet?
To be a poet. The poet side of it came from when I was younger, enjoying to write lyrics and stuff. So write our little songs, you know, you real little, have your little singing group and practicing in front of the mirror and stuff. But from then, in order to write lyrics, of course, you have to be poetic, you know. So I think that's where it started. I just love writing lyrics. And I still do.
What's your take on, and I think we talked to Butterfly about this too. What's your take on South Florida in terms of how we connect to the poetry scene and the, you know, the culture side? Like, South Florida, in my opinion, is not known to really gravitate to that. Like, I was always felt like I was weird because I love Neo Soul. And even now sometimes I feel weird because my husband is not into that. Right. And he's into music, but he's like, you know, he'll tolerate it for me. Right. But poetry, like, that's like, you like Neo Soul, right. Like, and I'm just, in Miami, it just seems like it's so far-fetched. Like, I would love going because I'm like, okay, I'm here with all the windows.
Right. Absolutely.
I don't feel alone. I feel like I'm normal.
And actually, that's how I started with the events. Because as an artist, you want to be able to go somewhere where you can display your talent, where you can have people to support your talent, where you can get new, you know what I mean, followers and fans. And like you say, it's not really that much here. Even when I started up and I was telling people I did, you know, I want to start a Love Jones. You saw the movie. And I had this whole vision. Mm-hmm. And they was like, that's really not South Florida. Like, nobody going to come. I mean, that's like Detroit, Atlanta or something. Nobody going to come. And we did it. And our people like us are the same thing. They want to go out and do that.
Yeah.
So even though it's not the majority, we do have a very artistic, intellectual, you know what I mean, crowd.
Conscious
here.
Crowd, yeah.
And a lot of the people, 2 years we've been doing Love Jones.
I mean, I've been to her event. I was selling my stuff at her event, and it was a nice crowd. It was a nice vibe. Like, for me, when I was, it's in Fort Lauderdale, but when I was, you know, single, ready to mingle, like, I don't like the club. I never liked the clubs. To me, I'd rather, can we just go to a lounge?
Yes.
But I found myself mostly going by myself because none of my friends at the time were into that. Like, I was the weirdo.
Right.
I'm still the weirdo, but, I mean, not really, because now I kind of narrowed down my friends to weirdos.
Mm-hmm.
We're all weirdos, I guess.
Exactly.
But I just think it make you feel in love. It make you feel like, you know.
It does.
Like, it puts you on a different vibe. You know, I don't want to hit nobody. I don't want to,
exactly.
You know. I just want to love somebody.
Yes.
That's all I want to say. So, single ladies, plug. You might want to hang out at a poetry spot. I'm just saying.
And that Love Jones is every second Thursday. Every second Thursday of the month. So, you know, anybody did want to come. At moments.
And it's
Tamarack.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And she also has, come on, you gotta sell yourself, girl.
Absolutely.
Sell yourself.
And I also have Eargasm, poetry and chill, and what that one is erotic poetry. So for people
for the grown
that
folks.
Like, yes. Nice.
See, my husband might like that one.
He may. I always tell people, come with open ears and an open mind, because the poet's going to say some things. You're gonna
he
hear
might
some
like
things.
That one. I might have to bring him to that one.
Awesome. And that one is at Foose.
Tell him, mama. Tell him. Come on. Come on.
In Pompano Beach. In Pompano Beach. And that was on the 4th Friday. On so we got Friday. That one coming up on the 23rd.
Okay. Yeah. Very good. So why did you become an author? Like, I know you write, but what made you say, you know what? I'm going to take this thing to a whole nother level.
Well, I think my first inspiration, because I told you I used to write stories, but I really didn't connect at that time of being an author. And then I read Omar Tyree. He has a book called Fly Girl.
Okay.
That was the first urban book I've ever read. Like, up until then, it was like, you know, books they give you at the library that everybody read. That was my first black author. And I was just intrigued that he talked like us. You know what I mean? Everything in the book was like stuff that we were familiar with. And that was like the first time that I said, wow, I could do this. You know what I mean? I could write a story. So it wasn't an easy world because I didn't want to self-publish. I really wanted to find somebody to believe in my work and back me. So it was a lot of no's, years and years of no's, you know what I mean? Yeah. And then finally, you know, got with somebody who read it and saw the vision with me and, you know, signed a book contract.
So what is Hood Love about? Why should I read Hood Love?
Hood Lemonade.
I mean, Hood Lemonade.
Now, Hood Lemonade is a book that comes from a real place that's intertwined with fiction. So basically what this book is going to give you, is a girl that's, first of all, let me say that Hood Lemonade is in South Florida.
Oh.
So when you're reading this story, you want to see places that you've actually visited, which a lot of people that live here appreciate.
Okay.
But, Jamaica is the main character in the story and she's an aspiring singer. Being that she's in the hood, she's just going through things that she have no control over. It's a progressive book, so it opens with her being 5 years old, witnessing a brutal rape. And from there, you know, you gotta read it. She goes through a series of things. But what I like to do in my urban fiction is two things. I want to bring you on experience. So I want you to be reading and stop like, oh, did I just read that? And whoever you do, you know it, you know? I want you to have an experience. And then secondly, I want you to be inspired. You know what I mean? Most of the people that read the book say that it brings them on a emotional roller coaster. And then at the end of the book, you feel inspired. You know, so you're writing a fiction.
So it's relatable.
It is. Very much so.
And I guess I feel like people are losing personal connectivity.
Yes.
And with social media and with so much other stuff, I'm just wondering, like, I remember a time when a lot of people would read and like Terry McMillan days and what was it, Elin Harris and those, you know.
Right.
But it seems like now people are so busy won't have time to read.
It is there is a pool of readers though. I probably see it more because I'm an author, so I deal, you know, with readers. So there are more people that read than you think, and especially more of us. You know, the most disturbing thing that I've heard that people say is if you want to hide something from black people, put it in the book. That's you know, to me, that's like the worst. So there is a lot of people that read of color, but I don't think it's broadcast like everything else. You know what I mean? A lot of other activities that you do, you broadcast. I do this and that. A lot of people that read, it's not like, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just... It's sad because I remember the days of, you know, everybody have a book club.
Shared books.
Yeah. Everybody has a book club.
Discussions about,
What would you say to someone? Because I'm sure it's someone listening that is thinking about writing a book or is thinking about, you know, wow, I wonder if I should take the plunge or you know, try. Right. What would you say to them?
Well, the very first thing is to write. Like, with anything you're doing, you have to perfect your craft. You know, you want it to the point where when people are reading, it kind of feels like a movie in the head. They could see everything in their own way. You want to write. And then the biggest thing is advice my mom gave me. And it's basically giving you a visual as if you're on a destination. You're in the car and you're on a destination. If you're trying to get somewhere that you really want to go to, it doesn't matter what happened if you get a flat tire. You're going to call AAA. You're going to hitchhike. You're going to do whatever you need to do to get back on that road to that destination. You might come abold in the road. You're going to drive around it. You know what I mean? So that's the biggest advice is don't give up. Just keep on that destination. You get those obstacles, fix it, get back on the road. And if you keep going towards that destination, you're going to get there.
You're going to get there. Exactly. Exactly.
Absolutely.
Let me ask. Are you currently self-publishing, and have you participated in any of the book fairs? But I think people not only want to know about what it takes, but like what takes us on a journey. Like, what are some of the things that you have to do on a regular basis?
Absolutely. To answer your first question, I'm not self-published. I'm with a publisher. I'm with Delphine Publications. It's a publishing house out of Atlanta. So I was lucky. I was shopping, like I said, for years to find somebody to pick up my book, and I finally did. So a lot of, you know, the expenses of publishing a book and doing all of that stuff, I don't have to worry about. The biggest thing is what I just said, right. You know, with all the other stuff that I have going on, I have to do a lot of writing. I do a lot of late nights and a lot of early mornings, you know. As far as book signings, I try to do everything that I can. If I hear people are having, you know, book vendors. Last year, I did the Black Women's Expo in Chicago, and I'll be doing that again. We'll be there the 6th through the 8th. Here, we have the South Florida Book Festival, which is at the African American Library here in Fort Lauderdale. So I'll be doing that one again. And then they also have a big VIP event in Atlanta, the African American Book Awards.
Okay.
That's in June. So I'll also be doing that. But yeah, I try to, you know, be everywhere I can that people, you know, are interested in books, book signings and things.
Okay, so That's about all the questions I have. At the end of the show, we normally allow the artist or the feature to, you know, sell yourself, tell everybody where they can buy your stuff.
Absolutely.
Where they can find you on Facebook, where they can find you on Instagram.
Right, I'll do all that. And do I have time for a poem? Or we about
Go ahead.
All right. So first, let me give my handles. I'm TJ Hope. You can find everything TJ Hope on my website, which is TanishaHope.com. That's TanishaHope.com. On Facebook, I'm TJ Hope. And on Instagram and Twitter, I'm author_TJ Hope. I wanted to share a poem with you guys because we've been talking about love of words. And I happen to have a poem called My Love Affair with words because I do. I am really in love with words. Like, I got, you know, a thing for words, a bad thing. So, yeah, I want to share this poem with y'all. And it's called My Love Affair with Words. First, before I start, am I allowed to curse at all? Or do I need to replace those words with other words?
How bad are the curse? Okay, go for it.
The flow of the poem.
Okay, go for it.
I can go for it. No.
You say no? Okay, Makeda says no. So replace the words.
Okay. I never thought a word could be the sweetest I've ever heard. Like kissing chocolate covered lips. Damn. I only added a verb. Whether you're written on pages or developed in stages, you're now. Wrap me up. This is delicious. Contagious. Your syllables and parables makes it undeniable that I felt for you. As long as I can read, write, listen to you, I'm never blue. Like glue intertwined by your stanzas, sonnets, and echo verse. Look what you do, baby. Let's write a haiku. You make me free verse. Ooh. And when you put that right lyric on me, there's just no place I'd rather be. See, you just get me. You massage me in places and fill in blank spaces, you make love to my mind. That hot spot most men can't find. Mm-hmm. You see, the way you spark upon is out of the norm. That thing you do with romance makes this love last. Erotica. You get so naughty. I'm begging for more, please. Got me feeling hot and bothered. Ready to come out my panties. Ooh, you a tease. That good mind freak, I'll never leave. All these things you do to me, they make his mind wonder. Is there another man, another love he starts to ponder? You see, it's hard for him to understand this complete and utter obsession. Characters, plots, and tragedy still in my attention. No, you see, there's not another penis. It's all in these metaphors that's causing these secretions. So if you like caressing these hips and tasting these lips, or spending quality time captured in my intimate rhymes, you have to understand you can never truly be my only one. Because this love affair I'm having with words, man, this shit got me strong. Sorry. And that's my love affair with words.
Hey. I'm snapping.
Snapping.
All right. And that is TJ Hope, ladies and gentlemen. All right. So, Makeda.
Yeah.
You ready? You can find us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. We're all over. Girl What? GURLWHAT. We're, yeah. You want to email us? You want to be featured? You can email us. GURLWHATMM@gmail.com. And we always end, well, we haven't been, but I'm going to make sure we do this time. We end with the scripture, Colossians 1:16. All things have been created through him and for him. And you have now been tuned into
Girl.
Girl, what?